Slide 1. Waves, Topic 05A, Part 1, The Nature of Waves. Slide 2. What are waves? There are many different kinds of waves, sound waves, light waves, seismic waves, earthquake waves, and so on. Waves are disturbances in mediums. The medium is the substance or material that the wave travels through. The energy of the disturbance gets passed along by the medium and then returns to normal. In the ocean, one water molecule bumps into a neighboring water molecule, which in turn bumps into another one, and it in turn bumps into another one, and it bumps into another one, and it bumps into another one, and so on. Like a row of dominoes, the energy is passed from one water molecule to the next, but each water molecule ends up moving very little overall, or not at all, after the wave has passed by. The wave itself is a pattern of energy that moves from one place to another place within the medium. The energy can move quite far, but the medium itself primarily wiggles or vibrates, it does not go anywhere, travel. The key factor required to sustain waves in a medium is a restoring force. The restoring force produces the wiggling or vibrating of the medium. For ordinary ocean waves, the restoring force is gravity, so ordinary ocean waves are called surface gravity waves. Imagine a small hill of water. The higher pressure beneath the hill owing to the weight of the water, the pull of gravity, pulls the hill of water downward and outward to the sides, the wave moves. The ocean surface overshoots, though, going down too far, and the ocean continues to bounce up and down for a while like a child on a swing who has to go back and forth several times before coming to rest. There are other restoring forces that can create waves. For example, surface tension, the electrical attraction, bonds, between water molecules also pulls the surface down or up. As you might imagine, this becomes important on smaller scales. Scientists call small ripples in water capillary waves. Since surface tension also results in capillarity, water rises up into small spaces like thin tubes, the bristles of a toothbrush, the holes in a paper towel, and so on, as we saw in the seawater chemistry lab. Slide 3. Wave orbitals, wave height, and wavelength. The crest is the top part of a wave. As a wave goes by, the water molecules beneath the crest move in a circle called a wave orbital. This is the key difference between a wave and a current. In a current, the water travels, it moves from place to place, like a river, but the water moving beneath a wave does not go anywhere, it keeps making the same circle again and again. Technically, the water goes a little faster at the top of the orbital near the crest than at the bottom, so it is not a perfect circle, so the water in waves moves forward a tiny distance overall after each cycle, but nowhere near as much as the water in a current. Slide 4. Wave orbitals get distorted into ellipses, ovals, in shallow water when the orbitals run into the bottom of the ocean. Thus, orbitals can be circular or oval. Notice that the water moves in circles or ovals of different sizes at different depths as a wave goes by, and that the circles or ovals near the surface are larger. Slide 5. The bottom of a wave is called the trough, and the top of the wave is called the crest. Slide 6. The size of the circles is controlled by the height of the wave, the distance from the bottom of the wave, the trough, to the top of the wave, the crest. The depth that the wave reaches down into the ocean with all those circles, called the wave base, is controlled by the wavelength, the distance from the crest of one wave to the crest of the next. A wave's orbitals reach down into the ocean a distance equal to about one half of its wavelength. Below the wave base, the water is practically motionless. Slide 7. These concepts are important, so they bear repeating. So, I am going to repeat what I just said with a different slide which illustrates the words in a different way. Notice that the water moves in circles or ovals of different sizes at different depths as a wave goes by, and that the circles or ovals near the surface are larger. The size of the circles is controlled by the height of the wave, the distance from the bottom of the wave, the trough, to the top of the wave, the crest. The depth that the wave reaches down into the ocean with all those circles, called the wave base, is controlled by the wavelength, the distance from the crest of one wave to the crest of the next. A wave's orbitals reach down into the ocean a distance equal to about one half of its wavelength. Below the wave base, the water is practically motionless. Slide 8. Wave interference. Unlike solid objects, waves do not bounce off one another when they come together. Instead, the actions of the water molecules add together, and the waves themselves momentarily combine or interfere. If two crests come together, the sea surface gets even higher. You would see one higher crest for a moment. Slide 9. If two troughs come together, the sea surface gets even lower. You would see one deeper trough for a moment. These two cases are called constructive inference, because they add or build upon one another, for a moment. If a crest meets a trough, they cancel one another. The sea surface gets flatter, the sea surface becomes less high than the crest and less low than the trough. This is called destructive interference, because the crest and trough disappear or are destroyed, for a moment. Slide 10. The interference lasts for just for a moment. After the collision, the waves keep moving forward in the directions they were going in originally with their original height. Think of ripples on a pond, how you can throw several stones in at once and how the circular wave crests move outwards and through one another. Experiment: get a rectangular container with a flat bottom, like a baking pan for brownies or lasagna, and fill it with just barely enough water to cover the bottom. Now, lift up one corner, and set it down quickly. Notice how this creates two groups of waves, one group bouncing between both ends and the other bouncing between the sides. These waves go through one another, momentarily adding or canceling, but they are not destroyed by their interaction. It is friction with the bottom of the pan that eventually saps their energy. Slide 11. The seemingly random surface of the ocean and rogue waves. When you usually look at the ocean, it does not look as nice and regular as the waves that I show on the previous pages. All crests do not have the same height, some crests grow and others sink, some crests move faster than others, and so on. It appears to be a big mess, but oceanographers have learned that underneath this complexity, the ocean is much simpler. The complexity arises from several different groups of waves coming from different directions, all arriving at the same place at the same time and momentarily interfering. Crests appear to grow and shrink, seemingly at random in some cases, due to crests from different wave groups coming together, growing, moving apart, shrinking, and sometimes canceling with a trough, disappear entirely. Slide 12. Wave interference is thought to be the cause of some rogue waves, huge wave crests that rise up suddenly and do not seem to come from anywhere. The ocean may be pretty calm as far as you can see, and then suddenly a large wave appears. Even the most experienced sailor cannot do anything to predict or avoid rogue waves. One kind of rogue wave is thought to be caused by a number of small wave crests from many different directions all happening to arrive at the same place, next to the ship, at the same time and momentarily interfering to make one large crest for just long enough to swamp or knock over the ship. The likelihood of this happening is, of course, 1 in a million, or more, but given enough time, it happens sooner or later. I guess you could say that people who get hit by a rogue wave won the lottery, but in a bad way. There are other potential causes of rogue waves and factors that can help create rogue waves, particularly waves moving against a current. Going against a current causes waves to grow larger, because it makes them slow down. The same thing causes waves to grow on a beach. Slide 13. Breaking waves. Waves begin to break when their steepness reaches 1/7. Together, the wave height and wavelength can be used to estimate the slope of the water's surface, called the wave steepness. If the wave steepness grows higher than 1/7, 0.14, the wave breaks. This is similar to what happens when any object is on a slope. If the slope is too steep, then gravity overcomes the friction between the object and the surface, and the object slides down the slope. On a wave crest, gravity overcomes the electrical attraction, bonds, between the water molecules on the surface, and water molecules start tumbling down the face of the wave. Experiment: place a small, paperback book, or similar object, on a larger, hardcover textbook, or similar object like a large cutting board. Slowly raise one end of the textbook, tilting the surface. You will notice that there is a certain angle at which the object starts to slide. It takes a much larger angle to make objects with great natural friction, like an eraser, to move. Notice that this is actually a pretty poor estimate of the actual steepness of the front of the wave. It is off by at least a factor of 2. However, as long as we all estimate wave steepness in the same way, it still tells us when and if a wave will break, just at a different value than the real slope. The advantage of using this formula is that it is a lot simpler to calculate and easier to memorize. Slide 14. Kinds of breaking waves, plunging and spilling breakers. Waves can break differently depending upon how quickly they cross the 1/7 steepness threshold. There are many ways to describe breaking waves. I like to split them into two simple categories, spilling breakers and plunging breakers. A plunging breaker is when the top of the wave gets far ahead of the bottom of the wave, causing a barrel or arc. This is the kind of wave preferred by surfers. In this case, the wave gets steep very quickly. It rapidly crosses the steepness 1/7 threshold. Since it takes time for a wave to break, this kind of breaking wave gets much steeper than 1/7 before finally breaking. A spilling breaker, on the other hand, gets steeper slowly. As its steepness grows a little above 1/7, water at the crest begins to slide, to spill, down the front of the wave, reducing the wave height and thus lowering the steepness back down to 1/7. As the wave approaches the shoreline a little more, it grows a little more, which causes the wave to break a little more. This happens again and again. In other words, the steepness hovers around 1/7. In short, a spilling breaker breaks slowly and gently over a long time, while a plunging break breaks quickly, more suddenly, almost all at once. I probably should add a third category of breaking waves, surging breakers. In this case, the wave never really breaks. The wave crest just keeps going forward and flows up the shoreline. This is what tsunami do. Slide 15. Wave speed. Deep water waves are waves whose orbitals do not touch the bottom of the ocean. Shallow water waves are waves whose orbitals run into the bottom of the ocean, distorting them into orbitals. Deep water waves move faster than shallow water waves. I like to say that the ocean bottom slows down a wave if it feels the bottom. Technically, this is not a frictional effect. It is related to keeping the water from completing the orbitals quickly by bending it off course. The shallower the water, the more the bottom gets in the way of the wave's orbitals and the slower the wave goes. Thus, waves move slower in shallow water and faster in deeper water. The speed of a deep water wave is controlled by its wavelength. The longer the wavelength, the faster a deep water wave moves. This means that if long wavelength and short wavelength waves start out together, they will eventually separate from one another, because the long wavelength waves will get ahead of the short wavelength waves. We say that the waves disperse. Slide 16. The winds of storms often create waves of many different heights and wavelengths, cause a very jumbled, complex, chaotic sea surface that bounces up and down, seemingly at random, because of the waves moving through one another and interfering momentarily. Slide 17. Because of the difference in their speeds, over time the waves tend to separate into groups with a more uniform wavelength and height, a phenomenon called wave dispersion. We call waves swell if they create a sea surface that rises and falls in a nice, smooth regular pattern. Swell results after waves have had a chance to move far from the storm that created them, when the waves of different wavelengths have had a chance to separate or disperse. The faster, longer wavelength waves are in the lead, and the slower, shorter waves length waves are in the rear. When waves of many wavelengths are all jumbled together, we say that they are sea waves.